He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please let me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And then he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. For the word of the Lord.
Jesus told his disciples a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, "In a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor had respect for people. In that city there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, 'Grant me justice against my opponent.' For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, 'Though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice, so that she may not wear me out by continually coming.' And the Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Be acceptable unto God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. If at first you don't succeed, try, try again. This saying could almost be the motto of the widow in our reading today. And for her, it certainly seems to have the desired effect. She receives the justice for which she craves, although the judge grants it to her for the wrong reasons, as we shall see. Jesus' parable is known as the parable of the unjust judge. Perhaps it is also the parable of the persistent widow. Perhaps it is both. This story only appears in Luke's Gospel, and I think it's wonderfully striking as it paints such a vivid picture of two opposing characters, almost caricatures. And we can see that the really human situation unfolds. We all know what it's like to be at the receiving end of someone who is persistent. It can be very annoying. Yet by the same token, we have also experience of being on the other side, of being persistent in our demands for something. Those of you with experience of children, or even perhaps you can remember from your own childhood, the persistent asking for sweets or ice cream, or perhaps nowadays something a lot bigger, a computer game, PlayStation or a new bike, can actually wear you down. At first you might resist and tell yourself you're not going to give in, but eventually their persistence does pay off. Anything for a quiet life, you might say. But if you think about it, it is their persistence which actually begins to wear down your resolve. You may not be giving in because you think they actually deserve what they're asking for, but their persistence exhausts and exasperates you. And this, it seems, is exactly what happens to the judge in our parable today. Here we have this hard-hearted judge who neither fears God nor respects other people, who is being pestered by this widow who keeps coming to him asking for justice. He refuses, but eventually she wears him down. "This widow keeps bothering me," he says, "so I'll give in to her demand so that she'll stop wearing me out." She has scripture on her side, which is in always in defense of the vulnerable widow. But the judge may even be fearing retribution from those who see his mistreatment of her. What were the hearers of this parable supposed to hear? How did the disciples respond? How do we hear it today? Is it not a really serious story about one small victory for justice in the face of rampant injustice? Our unjust judge and our persistent widow break down the stereotypes which we may expect. A judge who does not have compassion or respect for other human beings, who does not have a true sense of justice or honour, and who is perhaps one who could be bribed, all this makes us feel very uneasy. It's just not right. The irony here is that the judge should actually have been someone who saw that the widow did receive justice. What's more, initially he remains utterly unmoved by the widow's persistent pleas. He's more think about his own self-preservation and his his position in the community. As well as the judge, the widow doesn't conform to her stereotype either. Ultimately, she may not have been a poor, defenceless widow, vulnerable and without any resources. She could have been the Mrs. Pankhurst of her day, the figurehead of the suffragette movement, who in her dogged persistence inspired countless others to follow her example and seek justice for women. Or you may think of Florence Nightingale or Elizabeth Fry or Rosa Parks. But ultimately, as we know, their persistence paid off too. Closer to home, from her photograph, my great-grandmother Sarah Ann was a very feisty lady. With the help of newspaper articles, I've been able to piece together her battle with the Tredegar Coal and Iron Company way back in 1900. It was unusual for a woman to take a company to court. Her 20-year-old son, Aaron, who had only been down the mine for 2 weeks, was killed by a roof fall. Sarah Ann took on this large company for negligence. She took the company to court to fight for justice for her son, and she was successful. It was described as an embarrassing case, as the judge didn't know how much to award her. Eventually, he awarded her £31.04 and costs, which in today's money would be about £3,100. But it wasn't the money. Financial compensation wouldn't bring back her son. But Sarah was motivated by a strong desire for justice. I have to add at this point that my great-grandfather, who was a quiet, gentle man, kept out of this altogether and left it to his wife to sort it out. Like most of Jesus's parables, this one is open-ended. It leaves us to think about its meaning and perhaps jolt us into a new way of seeing God. We have to leave behind those stereotypes and try and see what God is really like. What is true justice, and how can we help to achieve it? Nothing could be clearer in our parable today than the fact that the judge here is definitely not like God. Surprisingly enough, it is the widow who is more God-like. She is the one who doggedly resists injustice. She is the one who faces it, names it, and persistent in her search for justice. The persistence of one apparently powerless widow achieves victory through justice. She has power far beyond that of a corrupt and unjust judge. She, like God, can inspire and encourage all of us to see through and overcome the enormity of all the seemingly impossible causes, to confront all the injustices of our world: racism, sexism, ageism, oppression, political and economic. There are countless people who are struggling for justice in our courts today. Just think of the former post office employees who were wrongly charged and convicted of fraud and embezzlement, many ending up bankrupt or in prison with their lives ruined. Their cases for compensation still continue. In many countries, there are injustices regarding people's basic human rights because there is oppression, modern form of slavery, wrongful imprisonment or death. Our minds turn to the young women in Iran at the moment. And Prisoners Week, which ended yesterday, aims to encourage prayer and awareness of the needs of prisoners and their families, and also victims of offenders, and also for those wrongly imprisoned or on remand for a long time when they are in fact innocent. Maybe some causes seem just too overwhelming to take in. But the image of the widow in our story today must serve to encourage us that when we sometimes lose heart and become dejected in our efforts towards justice, it is a realistic way too, not to try and overturn the world all in one go, but to have that gritty determination to carry on, which is done through prayer.
Our reading is introduced with Jesus telling his disciples about their need to pray and not lose heart. But we can all identify with the disciples, for many of us have trouble with prayer. The need never to lose heart. This is certainly one of the bigger challenges for our faith. Sometimes we lose confidence and think we don't know how to pray. We haven't got the right words. We may doubt that God even hears us. Perhaps our prayers are not being answered in the way that we would like. But Jesus' references to prayer have to do with the coming reign of God, about trying to live the future reign of God in the present. When in the words of the Lord's Prayer we pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done," we are asking for justice here on earth, because this is how we imagine it to be in heaven, where love and justice reign. Scripture is full of stories of men and women who persevere in prayer and of God's response to their prayers. We have one such example in our first reading, how Jacob wrestles and refuses to accept a no, even when wounded. His perseverance leads to his name and destiny being changed by God. At this stage in Luke's Gospel, Jesus is already setting his face towards Jerusalem. We know that Jesus will face those accusers who have only their own interests at heart. Jesus will not receive justice at the hand of the chief priests, Herod or Pilate, but he continues to pray to his Father, whatever will happen. It seems to me that we are all on that learning curve if prayer and faith stand together. Perhaps it becomes easier if we remember that God recognizes our needs even before we do. We long to pray and learn to pray and to persist with our prayer. Not so that we can change God, but so that God can change us and help us enjoy that fullness of life that God intends for us, both here on earth and in the kingdom to come. Amen.
Father and the Son.
will say, God of justice and truth, to which the response is, hear our prayer. God of justice and truth,
hear our prayer.
Bound together in the spirit of Christ, we turn in humble intercession to the Father, mindful of his love and mercy, as we pray for the needs of the whole world. Gracious God, we pray for your church throughout the world and for all people, for the renewal of the church in faith, love, and service, for all who minister in parishes, hospitals, and prisons, for the life of this church and parish. We give you thanks for the gift of your word, the grace of the sacraments, and the fellowship of your people. God of justice and truth,
hear our prayer.
God of justice, you judge all people with righteousness. We pray for all who are denied justice and all who suffer violence at the hands of others. We cry out to you against injustice and violence in the home, in the street, in finance, in the world. We pray for a peaceful solution for all conflict and war. We give thanks for mediators and all those who seek to bring justice, peace, and reconciliation. God of justice and truth,
hear our prayer.
At the end of Prisons Week, we thank you, Lord, for offering freedom to all people. We pray for those in prison. Break the bonds of fear and isolation. Support with your love prisoners, their families and friends, prison staff, and all who care. Heal those who have been wounded by the actions of others, especially the victims of crime. Help us to forgive one another, to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly together with Christ. God of justice and truth,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, we pray for all who are in need. We remember the hungry, the unemployed, the homeless, the outcast, the lonely, the rejected, the forgotten, those in captivity, and those who struggle to see a way forward in their lives. May they be comforted by your hope and joy. God of justice and truth,
hear our prayer.
Comforting God, we pray for all those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, and all who care for them. We pray for those for whom this day will be long and hard, for those struggling with despair or depression, for those in hospital and at home. We pray especially at this time for Joanna, Aonia, Janet, Hilary, Rosemary, Alice, Cam, Jan, Andrew, Ralph, Nathaniel, Neville, Ayla, Wendy, Sue, Sarah, and Edward. In your goodness and mercy, grant them health of body, soundness of mind, and peace of heart. We remember friends and loved ones who have enriched our lives and are now departed from us. We pray for those who have died in recent days, especially for Brian Lamble, Maureen Hawkins, Eileen Lamble, Sharon White. We remember too with love and thanksgiving those whose anniversaries occur at this time. Sylvia Crawford, Frederick Fisher, Mary Creedy, Jean Lightfoot, and Ernest Taylor. May your light shine on them forever and our lives be richer
because of their memory. God of justice and truth,
hear our prayers.
God of justice and truth, we pray for ourselves. Give us the eye that is willing to see the meaning of the ordinary, the familiar, the commonplace, to see our own faults for what they are, to see the likable qualities in everyone, to recognize the mistakes in what we thought was correct, to understand the strength in what we labeled as weakness. May we always see the world through the eyes of Christ, speak to those we meet with the words of Christ, and take with us on our journey the peace of Christ. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed
are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. The Lord be with you. Remember, Lord, your church in every land, Reveal her unity, guard her faith, and preserve her in peace, and bring us at the last with the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. John the Baptist, and all the saints, to the vision of that eternal splendour for which you have created us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise.
Thank you.
thank you, O Christ, for this sacred feast. For here we receive you. Here the memory of your passion is renewed. Here our minds are filled with grace. And here a pledge of future glory is given, when we shall feast at that table where you rest with all your saints forever. Amen. Just one or two messages, notices, but I really think we will have to look at the children's work this morning because they all came up to the altar with fingers on their fingers. Would you like to come and show them to us? Holy Spirit, be among us and remain with you all.